according to what we've discovered through our Apostle Paul. Need believers seek additional blessing today? Let's ask that question in connection with Thanksgiving. Hopefully you all know the answer. Do believers have reason to be grateful today? Should believers have a continual mindset of thanksgiving to God? We know the answer to that as well, do we not? Gratitude is an attitude, and thanksgiving is simply the expression of that gratitude. Someone said, "We are so earthbound." And that caught my attention. What a true statement. We are so earthbound. You see, most people live in a world of fantasy, if you think about it. They fantasize about a lot of things. They fantasize about becoming wealthy. We go to work, we get up, we eat, we sleep. We go to work, we get up, we go to bed, we eat, we go to bed, we sleep, we get up, we go to work. And we do that every day of our lives, fantasizing about what will be. People fantasize about becoming wealthy, becoming healthy, becoming popular, becoming famous, becoming any number of things. They're either dreaming about what yesterday should have been or dreaming about what they'd like tomorrow to be. And never really knowing the freedom of grasping today and being grateful today for that which can never be taken away. What God's given us, folks, we cannot lose. And he's given us the prescription for his glory and our good. He's given us the prescription, we called it a formula early on, for mental health and well-being today. And thanksgiving is an extremely important part of that prescription. Paul bursts out with it here in Philippians 1:3, and he tells us what his thanksgiving is for. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you folks, he writes here. And we'll be exploring, as I said, we'll be exploring that further next week. Just understand, Paul's life was characterized by thanksgiving. It probably wouldn't hurt us to go through every passage where Paul gives thanks and examine the context and the purpose for his thanksgiving to God. Wouldn't that be an interesting, nice little study to conduct? Thanksgiving is part of Paul's prescription for joy. Will we take the formula? Will we apply it, or will we leave it in the medicine cabinet of his word for a possible future time in our lives, and we just live in our depressed states? We should be thankful every day of our lives, folks. Thanksgiving shouldn't be just a part of our day. It should characterize every day that we have. Paul talked about redeeming the time. Of course, he talked about that in another context. But think about redeeming the time in the context of thanksgiving for a few moments. Certainly wouldn't hurt us, would it? You know what Paul's doing here? Paul's teaching us how to pray. Paul's teaching us how to pray here. Thanksgiving should be the grace age theme for the grace age believer, the grace age believer's prayer life. Thanksgiving should be the foundation of all of our prayer. Should be thanksgiving. He's teaching us how to pray. You may have come to see and come to realize that I never call upon anybody to pray here. How many have noticed that? How many are thankful for that? I see some hands. You know why that is, and some of you have heard the story. I wasn't saved, but I was in Youth for Christ, and I was called upon to pray and to give a testimony in a church when one of the pastors saw me sitting out there. Oh, there's Curt Crist from Youth for Christ. Curt, would you stand up and give us a short word of testimony and lead us in a word of prayer? And I had neither a testimony nor a prayer. I was simply having fun on a drum set in an organization called Youth for Christ. I ran. I didn't run, literally, from that. I think I sunk under the seat. But I ran from attending services anywhere in any assembly where I couldn't hide, because I never wanted to be called upon to pray again in public, ever. I didn't know how to pray. I had nothing really to pray for. We sold crosses on our table to make money, big crosses, and of course all the, especially the drummer and the musicians, we had to wear those big crosses around our necks so folks would understand and run to the table and buy a cross. That's what we wore them for. And I had a Baptist pastor, thank God for him, one day that said, "What's that cross mean to you, son?" just before we performed. And I said, "It doesn't, I'm not wearing it to make a statement. I'm just wearing it so people will see it and buy it." I was pretty honest. And he said, "But what's it mean to you?" And I said, "I'm not wearing it for a meaning. I'm wearing it so people will buy the crosses on the table. You know, it costs for us to do this, and we love to do it, and we need the sales." He didn't stop me from performing that day. He didn't say, "Well, I'm sorry, but I can't have you playing the drums in my assembly." You know what he said? He said, "Well, I challenge you to come to a point in your life where you know what that cross means to you, Search it out. I never forgot those words. Of course, when I later discovered what it meant that Christ died for my sins, his words to me came back to me. We have so much to be grateful for today. The crosswork of Christ, item number one. But he didn't stop there. He went on to bless us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places as we are in union with his Son. Paul's telling us here, you want to know how to pray. You want to know how to pray so that you needn't feel embarrassed that you don't know what prayer is all about. Just fill it with thanksgiving. Think about what Christ has accomplished for you. And prayer, whether public or private, can be directed at thanksgiving to God based upon what he's accomplished through his Son on your behalf. That's how to pray today in the age of grace. Fill it with thanksgiving. It should be the theme of Grace Age prayer for every Grace Age saint. Now let's close with one of the verses with which we began Paul's handbook on joy this morning. Isaiah 26:3. Don't have it in here. I'll read it. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusteth in thee. I love Paul's statement in Philippians 1:3. I thank my God. And then he adds, upon every remembrance of you. And we'll talk about that further in our next study. Let's thank him this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning, first and foremost, for the wonderful gift of your Son, that you were willing to take upon yourself flesh on this planet and to die for our sinfulness, for our sin, for our sin nature. You were willing to give your perfectly righteous Son for us, to make him sin on our behalf, that we might have his righteousness attributed freely to our account. We thank you. We have so many things to thank you for. You didn't stop there. You then blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. We can hardly fathom what all that means, what all you've provided on our behalf. We just thank you. We can never thank you enough. You are a wonderful God, and we thank you this morning. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.